In the last few lectures, we have discussed temperature, we have discussed thermometers, and we have discussed temperature scales. You were told that the two most prevalent temperature scales are the Celsius scale and the Fahrenheit scale. We also discussed Newton's law of cooling. We found that a body cools according to an exponential curve in a cool atmosphere. Similarly, in a hot atmosphere, a cool body heats up again along an exponential curve. Today, we start with thermodynamics. As the name suggests, thermodynamics is the study of flow of energy, either into systems or out of systems. And it also deals with the transformation of thermal energy into different kinds of energies. We must remember that thermodynamics deals with only macroscopic quantities. It deals with pressure, volume, and temperature, which are bulk properties of a substance. And the relation between these bulk quantities, which are also known as state variables, is called an equation of state. For example, PV equal to mu RT is the equation of state of an ideal gas. We have discussed last time what an ideal gas is. So, you must know what an ideal gas is. Any process which involves generation, storage, dissipation, transformation, transmission of energy must obey the laws of thermodynamics. For example, boiling of liquid, cooling of a liquid, phase change from liquid to vapor, these are all processes which require the laws of thermodynamics. Metabolic processes such as digestion, respiration, and cell division, these processes take place in our body and they also need laws of thermodynamics. Working of cooler, air conditioner, car engine, pressure cooker, thermometer, all these devices, they work according to the laws of thermodynamics. That is why the study of thermodynamics is essential, not only for physicists, but also for chemists, biologists, environmentalists, engineers, indeed for all scientists, because there is no process in science in which thermodynamics is not involved. So, we start with the Zeroth law of thermodynamics, which we have already done in the last few lectures. Briefly, what it means is that if A and C are in thermal equilibrium and if B and C are in thermal equilibrium, then A and B must also be in thermal equilibrium. And remember, only when a substance is in thermal equilibrium that we can assign temperature to that substance or assembly of particles. Let us see the first law of thermodynamics, which is concerned with conservation of energy, that energy can be transformed into other forms of energy and the energy cannot be destroyed or cannot be created. The examples are conversion of thermal energy to mechanical energy, chemical energy, or electrical energy. The law states that the change in the internal energy of a system is the difference between the heat energy supplied to the system and the work done by the system. The statement that I have made above contains three quantities: internal energy, heat energy, and work done by a system. We shall discuss each of these briefly. Internal energy. As the name suggests, this energy is internal to the system. It is due to the motion of its microscopic particles. It does not include energy due to the macroscopic motion of the system. That is, if the system is there, if it moves, then this is not included in the internal energy. The energy that goes into the bulk motion of the system is not included into internal energy. Only the energy due to its microscopic particles is included in the internal energy. Broadly speaking, it is a function of the temperature of the system. Let us see what this internal energy looks like. For monoatomic gases and for polyatomic gases and for liquids or solids, we have all three, and let us see what constitutes the internal energy of these systems. Kinetic energy due to translational motion of particles of the system is common to all. Then the monatomic gases cannot rotate or vibrate. Therefore, this rotational and vibrational kinetic energy forms the part of internal energy only in polyatomic gases or liquids or solids. The potential energy due to atomic bonds, this is again possible in both of these, the polyatomic gases as well as liquid and solids. The potential energy due to molecular interactions is possible only in liquids or solids, not in polyatomic or monatomic gases. So, these things constitute the internal energy of a system. Though internal energy of the system has been attributed to the kinetic and potential energies of its particles, it is macroscopic variable. In fact, it is a state function and depends only on the state of the system. It does not matter how that state has arrived. In this figure, suppose I talk of state 1, which has bulk properties of P1 and V1. The internal energy would depend only on the state, not how I arrived at this state, by this path or by this path or by this path or by this path, it does not matter. The internal energy depends only on the state of the system. It does not matter how the system has arrived at that state. The other thing that we talked of in the statement of the first law of thermodynamics was heat or thermal energy. Heat or thermal energy of an object is the energy due to motion of its molecules and atoms. We saw in the last lecture how the particles of gas, they are in always random motions, and they are their energy is the thermal energy of the system. When thermal energy is taken out of the object, its molecules and atoms slow down. We say that the object has cooled down. When thermal energy is given to an object, the kinetic energy of motion of its molecules increases. I have shown here, this was at temperature T1. We give some heat so that the temperature is raised to T2, and now you see that the motion of these particles have a larger amplitude than here. That means, we say that the body has increased its temperature from T1 to T2. Work done. This was the third thing that we talked of in this statement. You know, in physics, work done is F dot ds, where F is the force, vector force, ds is the vector displacement. And if the two are not in the same direction, then the work done is F ds cos theta, where theta is the angle between the displacement and the force. Notice that F cos theta, if F, this is the force, this is displacement, then F cos theta is the component of the force in the direction of the displacement. Now, let us see what in the case of a gaseous system, for example, what this work done means. So, what we have done is, we have taken a cylinder fitted with a piston, which can be moved up and down, and suppose we heat the gas, it will expand. Obviously, when you heat a gas, it expands. If it expands, it can push the piston up. If you want to keep the volume constant, then we put extra pressure so that the piston stays where it is. You see, let me repeat, we allow the gas to expand. Obviously, when the gas expands, it will tend to push the piston up. But if we want to keep the volume constant, then we have to put extra weight on the piston so that the volume remains constant. If we allow the gas to expand, the gas will push the piston up. Suppose the change in volume of the gas is dV. We allow the gas to expand by an amount dV. Then the work done by the gas in pushing the piston is pdV. You can verify that pdV has the dimensions of work. Even otherwise, you can see if P is the pressure, then the force is P into the cross section of this vessel. And if dx is the increase in the distance, then the force times distance becomes P times dV. Convention is that when work is done by the system, it is given a positive sign. When the work is done on the system, suppose you want to compress a gas, you will have to do work from outside. When the work is done on the system, this work is carries a negative sign. So, the work done by the system is positive, the work done on the system is negative. Whenever work is done on the system, the internal energy of the system can increase. When work is done by the system, its internal energy decreases because of the relation between the internal energy and the temperature. If we denote by du the change in the internal energy, by capital U we denote internal energy. Therefore, du is the change in the internal energy of the system, and by dq the heat energy supplied to the system. Then, according to the first law, the change in internal energy is equal to the heat given to the system minus the work done by the system. Look at this diagram. dq is the heat given, this is the system. du is the change in the internal energy and the rest goes into dw, or dq is the heat given, dw is the work done by the system and the balance is the change in the internal energy. You can look at whatever way you want to. So, du is dq minus pdv. Here, dw is the work done by the system. Some texts would write this law in this form, that the heat given is equal to the change in the internal energy plus the work done by the system. It does not matter whichever way you write. If I draw a graph between P and V of a gas, the pressure and its volume, then this is known as an indicator diagram. The relation between P and V is called an indicator diagram. And if the pressure is constant, then obviously the work done is P into V2 minus V1. The process at constant pressure is called an isobaric process. Bar is for pressure, so it is isobaric process. Now, suppose the pressure does not remain constant, then the indicator diagram becomes like this. P changes and V changes, so this is the indicator diagram. So, how do we find the work done? We take a small slice of this covered area and we assume that for this slice pressure remains constant and this slice is dV, then the work done is PdV, and we can erect infinite number of slices of this kind and we can add all those slices to get the total area of this colored area. And this is equivalent to integral PdV from volume V1 to volume V2. So, that is the work done. So, work done is integral of PdV from V1 to V2, and this equals, as I have been saying, the area of this shaded space under the curve. This is the curve indicator diagram and this is the area under the curve. Now, how can we get the work done PdV? We must find a relation between P and V, and one of the relations that we know is PV equal to mu RT. So, if we use this relation, we can find the work done, but this involves two variables and there are three variables. So, we have to keep one constant to be able to integrate this PdV. So, we will see there are three cases where P can remain constant, V can remain constant and T can remain constant. If P remains constant, the process is known as isobaric. If V remains constant, the process is known as isochoric, and if T remains constant, the process is known as isothermal. So, we consider all the three possibilities. In the isothermal process, the work done can be written as W equal to integral of PdV, which is mu RT, because T is constant, I can take it out of the integral and then I can integrate the rest. The work done is mu RT log, this is natural log, not log to the base 10, this is natural log, log to the base E. So, log V2 by V1. Isobaric process, isobaric when the pressure remains constant. In this case, it is simple. If the pressure remains constant, the work done is P into V2 minus V1 as we have seen earlier. The important case is of adiabatic process. An adiabatic process is one in which there is no exchange of heat between the system and its surroundings. The relation between P and V is given by PV raised to power gamma, which is equal to a constant, and gamma is the ratio of specific heats at constant pressure divided by the specific heat at constant volume. Using this relation again, we can integrate this integral and we get this relation. Since K is P1 V1 to the power gamma, K is a constant, equal to P2 V2 to the power gamma. So, we can use this along with the equation of state and we arrive at this relation in terms of temperatures. Work done in an adiabatic process is mu r times T1 minus T2 divided by gamma minus 1. We are now in a position to discuss the special cases. What is a special case? The first case is in which the volume remains constant. If volume remains constant, then PdV goes out and dQ becomes equal to dU. That is, whatever heat is given to the system is used in increasing the internal energy of the system, or if the heat is taken out, it is used in lowering the internal energy of the system. And you know from the definition of specific heat, it is a heat given per degree rise of temperature, and if it is constant volume, then it is Cv, and therefore, dQ can be written as mu Cv dT, where Cv is the molar specific heat at constant volume. And in this case, since dQ is equal to dU, dQ is equal to mu Cv dT, therefore, this is also equal to dU. So, dU is mu Cv dT, and you can see that from this I can get dU by dT is mu times Cv, and it is the result that we shall use later. If the process is isochoric, that is constant volume, then the temperature rises from T1 to T2, then the change in the internal energy is found by integrating dU by dT equal to mu Cv. That is, the internal energy is mu times the integral of T1 to T2 of Cv dT. Cv is kept under the integral sign because it may vary with temperature. Now, suppose the pressure of the gas remains constant, that is, there is no change in pressure, dP is equal to 0. Once again, following the definition of specific heat, we can write Cp as 1 by mu dQ by dT at constant pressure, so that dQ is equal to mu times Cp dT, where Cp is the specific heat per mole, that is molar specific heat. And dU now is dQ mu Cp dT minus PdV. And using the equation of state Pv equal to mu RT, it is possible to write at constant pressure PdV equal to mu R dT. You can simply differentiate this. Using this in the equation for dU, this equation, we can write 1 by mu dU by dT equal to Cp minus R, because it is mu R dT. Mu has been taken on that side, and you can now change the sides and you can write Cp minus Cv is equal to R, which is a very important relation. Cp minus Cv, that is the difference of the molar specific heats at constant pressure and constant volume is equal to the equal to R, the gas constant. As I said, the most important is the adiabatic process in which there is no exchange of heat, there is no change of heat, dQ is equal to 0. In this case, dU is simply plus minus PdV. If the work done is by the system, it is positive, and if the work done on the system, it is negative, and that changes the internal energy of the system because dQ is 0. So, the work done in this process, as we have seen earlier, is mu R T2 minus T1 by gamma minus 1. And last is dU equal to 0, then obviously dQ is equal to PdV. This means that whatever heat energy is supplied to the system, it is spent in doing work by the system. By the same token, if heat is taken out of the system, it is extracted from the system, the work must be done on the system. In this lecture, we started with the definition of thermodynamics. It deals with the flow of energy into the system, or flow of energy out of the system, or transformation of energy from one form into another. Then we saw that thermodynamics deals with only state variables, only with bulk properties like pressure, volume, temperature, and internal energy. Internal energy is the energy which is due to the microscopic constituents of a system. Although it is a state variable, it does not depend upon, it depends only on the state of the system at a given time. It does not depend how that state has been reached, but it is due to the internal motion of the particles, microscopic particles of the system. Broadly speaking, it depends on the temperature of the system. And the first law of thermodynamics is simply the statement of conservation of energy. And then we did several special cases. In the next lecture, we are going to take several problems based on the first law of thermodynamics.